Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome for our weekly webinar, weekly teaching program for our fellows. Today we welcome you for this session, which is on sickle cell disease. And I think I should thank Dr. Sangeeta for taking this topic today, because I know we have been discussing this topic less often and reading less often about this topic. So I take the privilege of introducing today's faculty, Dr. Sangeeta Mudaliar, who is the senior consultant and head of the Department of Hematology Oncology at BJ Wadia Hospital, Mumbai. So thank you very much, ma'am, for volunteering today and also moderating today's session. We have also, she has lined up esteemed faculty today who are going to be experts on the subject. And we have Dr. Deepti Jain. She doesn't need introduction to this audience. We have been hearing ma'am for many years. She's a professor and head of pediatrics at Government Medical College, Nagpur. And she's also, advisory member to a lot of other, committees and like ICMR and DBT. Dr. Chandrakala, who is a professor of clinical hematology at KM Hospital, and she, also does need introduction to this audience. We have been hearing ma'am at various platforms. Dr. Archana Swami, she is a senior consultant hematology oncology at BJ Wadia. And we also have Dr. Prashant, who also works at BJ Wadia Hospital, but he's, a main interest is in bone marrow transplant. And I think we'll probably hear his insights into bone marrow transplant sickle cell disease. And we have Dr. Purva Kanvindi, who is a consultant at BJ Wadia, and she's also going to be delivering the second didactic today. Sana is a fellow at BJ Wadia, and she's going to do the case presentation today. So, we have interesting faculty, interesting experts today. The format is the same. So we'll have two small didactics today on management of sickle cell and also what's new in the sickle cell field. Dr. Sangeeta and Dr. Purva is going to do that. And then post that, we'll have the case discussion with all the inputs from all the experts. Thank you very much, Dr. Sangeeta and team, for putting the session together, and over to you. We'll try to stick by to the time, so then we're finishing by 5:30. So over to you, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you so much. At the outset, I would like to thank Dr. Sunil Bhatt, Dr. Mamta Manglani, madam, and Dr. Neeta for inviting us to do this seminar. I will be covering a few aspects of diagnosis and management of sickle cell disease. My slides are not moving ahead.
Ma'am, you can just stop and restart your slide share.
Okay. Okay. So to have improved outcomes in sickle cell disease, it is very important to identify the children early, educate the parents, have some important preventive aspects, do the aggressive treatment of acute complications, screening programs for early signs of organ damage, and therapeutic interventions like transfusions and hydroxyurea, and sometimes stem cells transplant. I am going to only talk on the highlighted items in this talk. Prenatal diagnosis should be offered to all high-risk couples, and choice of termination of pregnancy should be given, as sickle cell disease is associated with significant morbidity and mortality. So there are various methods of prenatal diagnosis, which could be like invasive method, non-invasive methods, and pre-implantation genetic testing. With pre-implantation genetic testing, there are social and ethical issues. We all know about it. For invasive methods, chorionic villus sampling and amniocentesis are the gold standards. But with that, there is associated risk of fetal miscarriage. Non-invasive methods like identifying circulating fetal cells or cell-free fetal DNA in maternal plasma are newer tests, but they are not routinely available. With newborn screening, we can identify newborns and offer a comprehensive therapy for them. For newborn screening, either you can go for a selective screening or a targeted screening for high-risk parents, or a universal testing can be done. Universal testing identifies more infants with the disease and hence prevents deaths. In India, as of now, there is no newborn screening program going on, but a pilot study was done in few centers where a universal and targeted screening was done in the sickle cell belt. For the newborn screening, what is done is the blood is taken by either a heel stick method or by cord blood, and it is taken as a spot on the filter paper, and either by isoelectric focusing or HPLC analysis, the sample is tested. The abnormal result should always be confirmed with a second sample using a different method. There are three different patterns which can be seen in the newborn screening. One is FS pattern, second is FSA pattern, and third is FAS pattern. If FS pattern is detected, then it would mean there is a homozygous sickle cell anemia. The family should be informed about it, and a comprehensive care for the child should be started. If it's a FSA pattern, which would mean sickle hemoglobin is more than the adult hemoglobin, it means it could be a compound state like a sickle beta thal. Parents should be informed about that, and a confirmatory test, repeat test, should be done at 3 to 6 months to confirm or characterize the exact hemoglobin. If it's a FAS pattern, which would mean adult hemoglobin is more than the sickle hemoglobin, it means it's a sickle cell trait, and the family should be counseled about the reproductive consequences of the sickle cell carrier status, and other family members should be offered the hemoglobinopathy screening. There can be some diagnostic errors which can happen during the newborn screening. Like if we check a very preterm baby, the HbA may not be detected. So a sickle cell trait may be falsely labeled as sickle beta thal. Also, if we do the test after blood transfusion, we will not get a correct diagnosis. For the older children, we all know we should do a CBC, which would show a mild to moderate anemia, and the MCV is on the normal side. RDW is elevated, and there would be unconjugated hyperbilirubinemia. If we find that the MCV is not elevated, other possibilities like sickle beta thal or coincident alpha thalassemia or iron deficiency should be considered. This is a typical peripheral smear picture in which there are pointers towards the sickle cells, some target cells, and reticulocytosis and Hobble-Jolly, which could be seen in the peripheral smear. The conventional techniques for screening of sickle cell disease are sickling test using sodium metabisulfite and sickle solubility test using phosphate buffer solution. To confirm the diagnosis of sickle cell disease, produce high hemoglobin electrophoresis, isoelectric focusing, HPLC, or DNA analysis. HPLC is highly sensitive and specific, and it provides both the quantitative and qualitative interpretation. So it is very useful when you are doing a monitoring on hydroxyurea therapy. So what are the important points in monitoring and treatment of the sickle cell disease? Complete blood count, biochemical analysis like parameters for hemolysis, hepatic dysfunction, and kidney dysfunction. CBC in the up to 2 years of age should be monitored every 3 months. Beyond that, every 6 monthly monitoring can be done. Renal function annually and liver function annually. Other special investigations are transcranial Doppler. It should be monitored annually, starting from the age of 2 to 3 years. A CT or MRI in an asymptomatic child is not recommended. Also, a TCD is not recommended for a compound like a HBS beta thal or HBSC disease. How do we interpret the transcranial Doppler? If it is less than 170 centimeters per second, it's normal, and you just need to continue yearly monitoring. If it is more than 200, you should confirm the abnormal test within 1 minute, 1 month, and then repeat. If repeat is again more than 200, an MRI should be done, and a transfusion therapy should be initiated. If it's between 170 to 199, it should be repeated again in next 3 to 6 months. Ophthalmology screening should be done annually starting at the age of 10 years to screen for ischemic retinopathy. As per ASH guidelines, 2D echo is not routinely recommended for all the children. It should be done only if there are comorbid conditions like connective tissue diseases, or when the child is having leg ulcers, which may, leg ulcers or priapism, or there are disease complications which may be associated with pulmonary hypertension. Diagnostic echo should be done if you have cardiorespiratory symptoms. Similarly, pulmonary function test is not routinely recommended. It should only be done if there are cardiorespiratory symptoms. Renal studies should be started after the 10 years of age to monitor for microalbuminuria and proteinuria. Any child who has got proteinuria more than 300 milligram per day should be referred to a nephrologist. Any albuminuria should be confirmed by either a first morning urine sample or two consecutive untimed urine samples. All patients who have got a decline in renal function or eGFR below 60 ml, albuminuria, hematuria, or hypertension, a nephrology opinion should be sought. For albuminuria, ASH guidelines suggest to start with ACE inhibitors or angiotensin II receptor blockers. Bone health should be carefully monitored in all sickle cell patients. They should be evaluated by checking for vitamin D status, which should be performed annually, and bone density testing should be performed every 1 to 3 years after the age of 12 years. A physical examination to look for avascular necrosis should be performed. I'll cover a few important aspects about the red cell transfusion and sickle cell disease. So red cell transfusion, while can be life-saving in certain condition, it can be sometimes dangerous as well because it may cause hyperviscosity. So it should be done very carefully. Indication should be very carefully thought of. Post-transfusion hematocrit should not exceed 36%. A phenotypically matched sickle negative leukodepleted packed cell should be given. A red cell transfusion may be sometimes simple transfusion or an exchange transfusion, and we may require to do it either to correct anemia or to reduce the sickle hemoglobin. We may require to give it episodic or occasionally, or we may require to give it chronically. So episodic emergency transfusion is required to be done when there is evidence of physiologic derangement such as heart failure, dyspnea, hypotension, or marked fatigue, or the hemoglobin is less than 5, or there is 20% fall from the baseline. Also during aplastic crisis, sometimes in acute splenic sequestration and hepatic sequestration also you may require to transfuse, but you have to be very careful because the sequestrated red cells may return to the circulation. So there is high risk of hyperviscosity. Red cell transfusion is not routinely recommended in uncomplicated painful crisis. Again, the conditions like if the hemoglobin is less than 5 gram, or if there is 20% decline, then you may transfuse in case of painful crisis. Other conditions when you need to reduce the HbS in relation to HbA, that they are like acute ischemic stroke, where an emergency exchange transfusion is recommended. Acute chest syndrome, here we can do a simple transfusion with an aim of target hemoglobin of 10 to 11. Or we may require to do an exchange transfusion, especially if the starting hemoglobin is more than 9 and the simple exchange simple transfusion has failed. For multi-organ failure, aggressive exchange transfusion is required. Mesenteric or Girdle syndrome, acute exchange transfusion is indicated. In severe sepsis, often a vicious circle of tissue hypoxia, acidosis, and sickling happens, and exchange transfusion or simple transfusion may be helpful in this case. For intrahepatic cholestasis, there is no established treatment, but exchange transfusion may be beneficial. Acute priapism, benefit of transfusion to relieve established acute priapism has not been established. Episodic like transfusion may be required preoperatively. Like when there is a low or medium risk surgery, a simple transfusion should be done if the hemoglobin is less than 9, or a partial exchange if the hemoglobin is more than 9. And the aim should be to attain the hemoglobin of 10 and HbS less than 30%. If it's a high risk surgery, an exchange transfusion is recommended. there are certain indications when the children need to be put on chronic transfusion. So first, an important one of that is primary and secondary stroke prevention. Again, after a year, the aim should be to put the child on hydroxyurea therapy, and transfusion should be slowly withdrawn once the hydroxyurea has been escalated to the maximum tolerated dose. For recurrent acute chest syndrome, again, hydroxyurea is the preferred line of treatment. Frequent painful crisis, again, hydroxyurea is the first line of treatment. But if the child is having frequent painful crisis, which would be like more than admission more than three times a year, a simple or exchange transfusion, chronic transfusion may be done. A few important points about exchange transfusion. So exchange transfusion is most useful in situation where it is important to decrease immediate complications of sickle cell disease. Exchange transfusion helps to prevent further vaso-occlusion, but it does not reverse the pre-existing vaso-occlusion. It also reduces the rate of hemolysis, and the goal of the exchange should be to get the HbS level less than 30% and hemoglobin close to but not greater than 10. Indications we discussed while discussing about the episodic transfusions. Only one which we had not discussed is fulminant priapism, which lasts for more than 4 hours and is unresponsive to pharmacological therapy. In that case also, exchange transfusion may be required. So there are certain principles which should be followed when doing exchange transfusion. You should ensure that the child is well hydrated. Parents should be informed, and the indication of exchange transfusion should be communicated to the parent, and informed consent should be taken. Asepsis should be maintained during the procedure. Proper intake output should be recorded. Diuretics should not be used. During the exchange transfusion, continuous IV fluid should be going on to maintain proper hydration. Proper electrolyte balance, oxygenation monitoring should be continued. And we should remember that the final hemoglobin value should not exceed 10 to 12 to avoid hyperviscosity. Preferably take two vascular access, two ports, one for venesection and the other for administering the blood and saline. In certain cases, an arterial line may be used for a venesection. For some critically ill children, we may require to do for frequent exchanges, and it is ideal to keep a 4 to 8 hours break between the exchanges. It should be isovolemic exchange, and in children 5 to 10 ml per kg Ellicott should be used. So to calculate the volume for exchange transfusion, it should be 1.5 times the red cell volumes, and red cell volume can be calculated by multiplying the hematocrit to the total blood volume, which can be decided based on the child's weight, which is 70 ml per kilo for more than 20 kilos and 85 ml per kilo for less than 20. And then this is an algorithm on how to go in an adult. In children, you use 5 to 10 ml per kilo. So we start with bleeding first and then give saline infusion, then bleed again, and then infuse 2 units of packed cells. And then these steps are repeated till the whole volume is used. There are various formulas also which can be used to calculate the volume based on the desired hematocrit and the initial hematocrit. So I would just conclude my talk by saying that it is very important to diagnose the sickle cell early by offering prenatal and newborn screening. To prevent complications, screening for various organ functions should be done for all the patients of sickle cell disease. Blood transfusion is an important part of sickle cell disease treatment, but it should be done very carefully. And with that, I end my talk, and I would request Dr. Purva to start her talk.
So I would like to start my talk. So we'll be talking about review of landmark trials and advances in sickle cell disease. So the important trials which we'll be talking about is the Baby Hug trial, Hustle, Stop 1, Stop 2, Twitch and PROPS. So this is the timeline of hydroxyurea therapy for sickle cell anemia. So the Baby Hug trial was the first landmark trial which happened in the course of sickle cell disease. So your oral hydroxyurea was started for a period of 24 months in all children 9 to 18 months of age. And all children, whether they were symptomatic or asymptomatic. So it was observed that there was a 2.24 lower rate of pain, 5.24 lower rate of dactylitis, lower rate of acute chest syndrome. Asymptomatic at study enrollment, there were lower rates of dactylitis, splenic sequestrations, as well as fewer transfusions and hospitalizations were required. The hematological parameters as seen improved with HbF being improving, Hb and MCV being improving. The toxicity wise, severe neutropenia was very rare and was not associated with any invasive bacterial infections. So the conclusion of this trial was it was recommended for all children with sickle cell anemia, independent of the disease severity. It was well tolerated and there was no significant toxicity. So continuation of this, where the hydroxyurea was studied for its long-term effects, plus they tried increasing the dose to look for a maximum tolerated dose. So here it was seen that whenever the HbF levels went more than 20% in the maximum tolerated dose, the children had dramatically fewer sickle cell anemia related complications which required hospitalization. The next trial was that regarding stroke. So blood transfusions, it was known that they prevent recurrent stroke in children with sickle cell anemia. But the value of preventing transfusions in preventing first stroke was unknown. So transcranial, so for this trial was carried out. Children who had no history of stroke and who showed two transcranial Dopplers with more than 200 centimeters per second, they were assigned between a standard care and transfusions. It was found a 92% difference was found in the risk of stroke in those with prophylactic transfusion. So anybody who had an abnormal TCD was put on a prophylactic transfusion regimen. So now why the next study, which was STOP 2? So prophylactic transfusions were preventing strokes in children with sickle cell anemia, but it was not known how long the transfusion should be carried out. And there are long-term consequences of chronic transfusions. So children with a high risk of stroke, those TCD and who received transfusions for 30 months or longer and whose Doppler readings became normal, were assigned to whether to continue transfusion or whether to stop transfusions. So out of the 41 children in the transfusion halted group, high risk Doppler results were seen in 14 and stroke was seen in 2, causing an early termination of this trial. So your discontinuation of transfusion for prevention of stroke in children with sickle cell resulted in normal blood flow on TCDs and even in strokes. So the next trial again was seen to see whether any improvement can be, any alternative therapy can be provided. So here it was started with the hypothesis that hydroxyurea was non-inferior to transfusions for maintaining the TCD velocities after discontinuation of initial transfusion therapy. So your children who had received more than 12 months of chronic transfusions were given the option, were randomized between a standard and alternative therapy. Here the alternative therapy was hydroxyurea, which was started at 20 mg per kg per day per dose, and it was gradually increased to its maximum tolerated dose. Once it's reached its maximum tolerated dose, there was a tapering of transfusions which was done over a period of 4 to 9 months. And phlebotomy was carried on along with it. So here the first scheduled interim analysis showed a non-inferiority. And on long term, it was shown that for high-risk children with sickle cell anemia and abnormal TCD volumes, after 4 years of transfusions and more without any severe MRA vasculopathy, hydroxyurea therapy could substitute chronic transfusions to maintain the TCD velocities and help prevent primary stroke. So penicillin is another important drug which is used in our patients. So the PROPS trial, which was done in 86, showed an 84% reduction in the incidence of infection in the group which was treated with. We started by 4 months of age to decrease the morbidity and mortality which was associated with pneumococcal septicemia. So with this, we go on to the advances in the treatment of sickle cell disease. There are a number of mechanisms by which and drugs which are available. Your targeted therapy is used in pathogenic mechanisms which are responsible for manifestations of sickle cell anemia. So the first of which is L-glutamine. So why do you use L-glutamine in sickle cell? Oxidative stress contributes to the complex pathophysiology of sickle cell disease. L-glutamine will increase the proportion of reduced form of nicotine adenine dinucleotides in sickle cell erythrocytes. It reduces the oxidative stress and it could result in fewer episodes of sickle cell related pain crisis. So here it was used as a randomized trial with placebo controlled in patients between 5 to 48 years of 58 years of age. Glutamine was used in a dose of 0.3 gram per kg per dose in two divided doses over 48 weeks. And they should have had a history of at least two pain crises per year. A stable dose of hydroxyurea was maintained for 3 months. It was seen that L-glutamine resulted in. The other drug which is under study is crizanilizumab. The upregulation of P-selectin in endothelial cells and platelets contributes to the cell-cell interactions that are involved in the pathogenesis of vaso-occlusion and sickle cell-related pain crisis. Crizanilizumab is a humanized monoclonal antibody that binds to P-selectin. So this sustained study was done in 16 to 65 years of age and who had had 2 to 10 sickle cell related pain crisis in 12 months. The hydroxyurea dose had to be stable for 3 months, or if it was not started, then it should not be started. It was randomized between a low dose crizanilizumab, high dose and a placebo, and it was to see the annual rate of sickle cell related pain crisis. So high dose crizanilizumab also resulted in a 45.3% lower rate of pain crisis, as well as the median time to crisis was significantly lower, and they had a very low incidence of adverse effect as compared to the placebo. The other drug was voxelotor. So here the deoxygenated sickle hemoglobin polymerization is the one which drives the pathophysiology of sickle cell disease. Voxelotor is an HBS polymerization inhibitor which reversibly binds to hemoglobin to stabilize the oxygenated state. In this, adolescents and adults with sickle cell disease were tested, randomized between high dose, a low dose, and it was monitored for a hemoglobin response and markers of hemolysis. In the high dose, there was a 50% increase in the hemoglobin, which was observed within 2 weeks, and it was sustained throughout the study period, and it is irrespective of the baseline anemia and hydroxyurea use. There was a significant reduction in the markers of hemolysis as well. So both of these drugs are under study, and voxelotor has received a status and FDA breakthrough therapy status. The next line is gene therapy. So gene therapy, there are several possible gene editing strategies. One of them is to correct the causative point mutation in hemoglobin beta gene. The other is to induce the hemoglobin F through either introduction of the HPFH deletion or through downregulation of BCL11A. Also, it can be done through gene addition in the HB beta, HB gamma, or anticyclin beta globin cassette can be added, which causes a correction of the AT mutation or which produces high level enough levels of HBF, which could be curative. So this was one of the first studies with the gene therapy. In this study, a self-inactivating lentiviral vector, which encodes the human HB beta variant T87Q, was used. This inhibits the HBS polymerization. The T87Q substitution also allows for the beta globin gene to be differentiated by HPLC. The first patient was 13 years of age and had a pain crisis and had multiple chronic and was on chronic transfusion when he was taken up for the gene therapy. 15 months after treatment, the level of therapeutic anti-sickling beta globin remained high without any recurrence of sickle cell crisis and with the correction of biological hallmarks of the disease. So to end my talk, this is that the hydroxyurea still remains the standard of care. It is well tolerated and inexpensive. There are a number of targeted therapies which act upon the pathophysiological mechanisms of sickle cell and which are right now like L-glutamine are on the verge. Gene therapy is a promising cure, but it is expensive and currently under investigation.
Thank you.
I would now request Sana and Dr. Sangeeta to start with the case presentation.
Thank you, Purva. Sana, can you please start the presentation? We have two cases of complications of sickle cell. I would first thank Dr. Prashant, Dr. Archana Swami, Dr. Chandrakala, and Dr. Deepti Jain, who are the faculty and experts today. So Sana will start the case presentation.
Ma'am, I'm not able to share screen.
Is Sana given the host at this one?
Yes, ma'am. I have made her co-host. Yeah.
Sana, can we do it from here only? Maybe we can sit together and do it.
Okay, ma'am. I'll just come there.
Okay.
Purva, there are some questions in the chat box. In the meantime, we can probably address them or chat there, or if you want to speak out also, that's absolutely fine.
Good afternoon, everyone. Am I audible?
Yes, Sama, you're audible. If you could just put the PowerPoint presentation on slideshow. Otherwise, we can see the slides also.
Can somebody confirm whether the Sana is audible?
Yes, Sana, you're audible. You have to unmute yourself, Sana.
Good afternoon. I'll be presenting two cases on sickle cell anemia. So my first case is about 1 year, 7 months old male child, first by birth order, born of non-consanguineous marriage, resident of Palghar, Thane, wardly by community, came with complaints of fever since 4 days, cough and cold since 4 days, and swelling over both feet and hands since 2 days.
So, may I ask Dr. Deepti Jain, what are the high-risk communities for sickle cell anemia?
Hello? Hello? Yes, ma'am, we can hear you.
Okay. There are now 18 states where we have high prevalence of sickle cell disease now. And 5 states have very high percentage. Mainly they are scheduled caste, tribe. There are also other backward classes where we do get sickle cell disease and some tea growers. And the new thing which has come up is even in minority communities like Muslims, Christians, and even in general populations, we find sickle cell disease in around 5 to 8%. So that is something which has come up now that other communities are also having sickle cell disease.
Do you find any difference in the different communities? Like, you know, some cases may be severe and some less severe. And like comparison of sickle cell disease amongst Indians and African community?
Yeah, there are lots of differences according to the region, not even according to region, even within the same area or even within the family. If there are 2 children homozygous sickle, one will be very severe, admitted now and then every month, and the other would be was never admitted. So the phenotype is very variable. And within India, if you look at the severity, Gujarat is milder than the other places. Central India has the most severe type of phenotypic presentation. And also the type of clinical presentation varies from region to region. Like in Central India or other part of India, a leg ulcer and priapism is not very commonly seen. Yes, we do see, but very rarely. While if you go to Chhattisgarh, there are many cases of leg ulcer and priapism. So this is one example where I can say that the presentation is the phenotype, the clinical presentation is also different in different area.
Right. Okay. Thank you.
Coming to the history of present illness, fever was moderate to high grade, intermittent, associated with chills, relieved on medicines, and no diurnal variation. It was associated with a cold, noisy breathing, dry, non-productive cough. Mother noted swelling over both hands and legs since 2 days, which was associated with decreased movements of limb, and no history of vomiting, loose motions, jaundice, swelling anywhere else on the body. Similar history of history in past or blood transfusion in past and family. Past history, admitted for pneumonia at 11 months of age for 9 days. Family history was first by birth order, born of non-consanguineous marriage. No history of blood transfusion, gallstone, similar history in family. Birth history wise, he was a preterm 30 weeker, normal vaginal delivery. Birth weight was 1.7 kgs, cried immediately after birth. There was history of NICU stay for 7 to 8 days, for which no documents were available. Immunization history was immunized till 1 year of age. Developmentally was normal for age. And dietary history, he was on breastfeeding and complementary feeding was just started.
So now my question is to Dr. Archana. What are the common infections in sickle cell anemia? As we saw, this child also had some infections in early infancy. And like, what are the special vaccines which should be given for sickle cell anemia patients?
Okay, so in this child, you've already documented this one case of pneumonia, which happened earlier before he came to you this time. And we know that they have functional hyposplenia by the first year of age, and it's functionally asplenic by the time they're 5 years. So they are predisposed to the encapsulated organism infection, especially the pneumococcal infection. That is what we are most worried about. And it's possible that the pneumonia the child had in the previous infection was pneumococcal. So the other two organisms that are encapsulated are the H influenzae and the meningococcal. These are the three things that we really worry about. And we advise that they get vaccinated. Salmonella is, yes, thank you for putting up the slide. So Salmonella is another bug, both typhi and non-typhi, which cause osteomyelitis. It is also caused by other organisms. It can also be caused by staph or other gram-negative enteric bugs. In that order, but Salmonella osteomyelitis should raise the antennae and you must actually look for a staph infection. They can be, of course, all the viruses, and why we are more worried about in this child is because bugs like RSV can cause aplastic crisis. They can cause acute chest syndromes, and if they get infection with parvovirus B19 or ABVs, that again can cause a aplastic crisis because their cell turnover, the RBC cell turnover is so much faster. Hepatitis, you're worried about because they do get transfusions often. So they can get blood transfusion, transmitted hep B and E. So the vaccines that are recommended, of course, are the pneumococcal. In infancy, they should be getting the PCV, and once they cross 2 years of age, they should be given the PPV-23. This should definitely be taken care of, yes. And of course, the H influenza B starting at 2 months of age and the meningococcal a bit later. They should also definitely get the hepatitis B, and they should get yearly influenza vaccine starting at 6 months of age. So this is what is recommended for them.
Yeah, thanks, Archana.
Coming to the examination.
Weight was 8.4 kg, according to WHO chart, between 15th to 58th centile. Height of the baby was 78 centimeters, which was between 3rd and 15th centile. And head circumference was 43.5, which was between 3rd and 15th centile. General examination, baby was febrile with a temperature of 100.4 degree Fahrenheit with a heart rate of 140 per minute, respiratory rate of 36 per minute, no respiratory distress, BP was 96 by 60 mm of mercury, pallor was present, and edema was present over dorsum of both hands and feet. It was tender, not associated with increased temperature, redness, restriction of movement, and there was no icterus, lymphadenopathy, or cyanosis. Systemic examination per abdomen, it was soft, non-tender. Liver was palpable, 5 centimeters from the right subcostal margin. It was firm, non-tender, and a smooth surface with a span of 9 centimeters, and spleen was not palpable. Respiratory system, air entry was equal, and chest was clear. CVS was, S1, S2 was heard, no murmur. In CNS, baby was crying, it was irritable.
So this child has come in with a lot of pain and VOC-like symptoms. Dr. Prashant, how would we manage the pain in a child with sickle cell anemia and vaso-occlusive crisis? How is the management done? Can you please tell? Dr. Prashant, are you there? Prashant. Dr. Chandrakala, would you like to take the question?
See, this patient has typically has come with the veno-occlusive crisis. And when the patient comes with the veno-occlusive crisis, whatever the examination you have done is perfectly, we should always do the exam in the patient. The patient can come with fever and the generalized body ache. When the patient comes to you in the clinical setting, in the OPD or the emergency ward, you do the examination of the patient. What is the source? With the patient, what is the fever, respiratory rate? Chest examination has to be done. And first, most important thing is make the child comfortable, actually. So patient comes with acute chest syndrome, you start everything else, but don't give the painkiller. That becomes very, very difficult to manage. So you should identify, you already done, whether the patient has got any risk factors for the veno-occlusive crisis, diarrhea, dehydration. So those things has to be looked into the history and examination point. And then once the patient you have examined completely, then you come to the painkillers and the hydration status. Painkillers you can give, and usually what happens is most of the Western guidelines mentions about the opioids. For example, in our center, I mean any of the centers like you come, they will not be having any opioids on the counter. So you don't get the opioids. So in generally what we give is you give the paracetamol and diclofenac. But when you tell the patient diclofenac, when the patient is admitted in the hospital only, you should give diclofenac because it has got a lot of renal dysfunction. And sickle patients also can cause like papillary necrosis and renal dysfunction will be there. So along with hydration, you can give diclofenac and paracetamol. It's the better to start with both the drugs. And when the patient doesn't improve with these two things, then you go ahead and give the remaining painkillers. So usually what we give in our setup is we start with tramadol. But see, tramadol is contraindicated in children less than 12 years. You should not give because sudden seizures, death has been reported. So if the child doesn't improve with paracetamol and diclofenac, under observation, give tramadol. Keeping in mind, it can cause symptoms. More than 12 years, you can give tramadol. But other thing is, you can give transdermal fentanyl patch. The fentanyl patch also is available. See, morphine also, you can... It's like triplicate prescription has to be given. So then you can give arrange the morphine. So fentanyl patch is easy to get. You can give about 0.5 microgram per kg. So if you get about 12.5 microgram patch also is available. So you continue the painkillers and then give the patch because patch takes at least about 12 hours to act. So you continue the painkillers and then you give the fentanyl patch is a better one. If the pain doesn't subside with all this, then you have to give the morphine has to be given. So this has to be, and along with you have to maintain the hydration in the kid to decrease veno-occlusive crisis and correct the cause of the crisis.
Absolutely, I totally agree.
Coming to the investigations, CBC showed HbO 5.6 with MCV of 62, MCACA 18.6, MCHC of 29.8, and RDW of 20.1%. HCT was 18.1, total counts of 18,600 with neutrophilic predominance of 80%, platelets were 3.61 lakh, and retic was 0.2%. CRP was 267, bilirubin with a direct of 0.8, total of 0.8 and direct of 0.3, SGOT was 29 and SGPT was 56, alkaline phosphatase was 220, LDH was 913, protein and albumin were normal, BUN was 8 and creat 0.4, so electrolytes, sodium was 130, potassium 4.7, PSMP and optimal was negative. PS showed microcytic hypochromic anemia with sickle cells, sickling test was positive, HPLC was sent, X-ray was done of bilateral lower limb and hands, which was normal. Local USG was suggestive of subcutaneous edema of right hand and feet and no evidence of any obvious collection. So management-wise, he was started on hydration, injection paracetamol, injection ceftriaxone, syrup fluvir, tablet folvite, and blood transfusion with 5 ml per kg was given. This was the HPLC report which we got. So HBS was 76.8%, HBF was 17%, HBA was 3%, HBA2 was 3.2%, which was suggestive of sickle cell anemia. HPLC of the parents were also sent, which was suggestive of sickle cell trait. Gradually, fever and swelling subsided and patient was discharged on hydroxyurea, folvite and penicillin prophylaxis. Special vaccines were given.
So Dr. Chandrakala, we all know that even Dr. Purva talked about hydroxyurea. Hydroxyurea is treatment for sickle cell anemia. But can you please tell, like, when should we start it? And like, it is available in capsule form. So how should it be given to children? And once we start it, how do we monitor? What are the important tests we should be doing?
See, initially hydroxyurea was given only in patients who had more than 3 vaso-occlusive crisis, chest syndrome. But now it is not that. Now we have to give it as a universal drug actually. Because sickle cell anemia has got many other unknown, like kidney dysfunction, pulmonary dysfunction, and hydroxyurea in adults has shown decrease in mortality. So hydroxyurea should be given to all the kids more than 9 months, because we have a study, baby hug trial has proven, started in the children more than 9 months of age. So giving, we have only capsule of 500 milligram, difficult to give. But in baby hug trial, what they have done is, you open the capsule and dissolve the powder in a sterile water. So you can tell our patients to boil the water and we can use it actually. Boil with sterile, wash your hands and then prepare the solution. So you have to put the powder in the solution and stir it properly. Means like you should vigorously stir it. So there should not be any precipitates. Like that it should be. We can make it like 200 milligram per ml or 100 milligram per ml can be done. So in the baby hug trial, they used about this solution for 3 months. But because of considering the lot of problems with like keeping the solution, the risk of infection, we can use maybe 1 or 2 days, they can use the same thing and prepare freshly. That's what we tell our patients. That would be the most appropriate method to start in pediatric patients. And the studies actually in patients who has got anemia, chest syndrome, or the patient with painful crisis, you can start with 10 to 15 milligram per kg, rounded at 2, whatever the dose is convenient. And in patients who has got a stroke, in patient who has got severe anemia, those patients, hydroxyurea may not always be benefit. In those patients, you have to give maximum tolerated dose. So when you start the patient on 10 to 15 milligram per kg, you do the CBC at least every month for the initial 3 months to look for the myelosuppressive effect. See, hydroxyurea people, you should not advise them to give twice a day or thrice a day. It is better to give once a day, because the mechanism of action is like that. It causes myelosuppression and HbF induction. So you should give preferably in the morning as a single dose. 10 to 15 milligrams should be started. After 4 weeks, you do the CBC. And the ANC should be more than 2,000 and platelet count should be more than 80,000. That is the aim of doing a CBC. Sometimes these patients are very from the tribal area. So don't, just because the patient is not responding, you think like HbF is not increasing, it's not the indication to increase. Patient has to come back to us at least every 3 months to seek the myelosuppressive effect. The patient cannot come back, you start the drug and you can low dose, but don't keep on increasing. You have to pay, what do you see for monitoring for the response is clinical symptoms at the HbF levels. HbF levels you can do once in 3 months to 6 months is enough to do, but routinely it is not recommended. If it's not possible, don't do it actually. Observe the clinical effects of the drug can be seen only, and then monitor the MCV. See, patient tells we take the drug, but MCV is not increased, they may not be taking the drugs. So indirect monitoring is MCV, see the MCV, it's increased in patients on hydroxyurea. So that is how we can monitor the adherence to the drug. Sometimes the patient stops for about 1 month, takes for 3 months. But that is also, you should counsel them. They have to take regularly of the drug to see the effect of the drug. So at least you have to continue the drug for long term to see the effect of the drug. Without, just because they don't have HbF, don't stop the drug. That is an important message I would like to convey.
Thank you so much. Very well summarized, Dr. Chandrakala. Dr. Archana, what is the role of penicillin prophylaxis? And like, where do we start and how long to continue?
Okay, I think Purva's already touched upon it, right? The PROX trial in 86 very elegantly demonstrated that when penicillin was given, we mentioned the doses for less than 3 years, what we recommend is 125 milligram twice a day. And more than 3 years of age, it's recommended to be 250 milligrams twice a day. It has to be started almost as soon as you diagnose the patient. So this trial, the PROX trial, said by 4 months you need to start. and ideally at least continue till about 5 years of age. Now, not everybody agrees on whether it should be stopped at 5 years of age. According to some people, there was a trial and they said that there isn't increase in significant infections after 5 years of age if it is stopped. But according to others, it should only be stopped if the child has been properly immunized against pneumococcal, if there hasn't been a splenectomy done for any reason, for example, if the child had repeated episodes of sequestration, or the child should not have had an invasive pneumococcal infection. So, but I think for most of us, we do stop at 5 years because it's difficult for them to continue indefinitely.
Yeah, and can you please tell, like, if the child is allergic to penicillin, what can be done? Or say in between there was penicillin was not available, what are the other options?
Yeah, erythromycin, as is mentioned on the slide, is the alternative to penicillin, which should be given.
Yeah,
and of course we have to educate the parents about fever. They need to come in immediately, and it's not just fever. Okay, we're talking about infection, so it's just fever, anything they see different in the child. If the child suddenly appears very pale, they still need to come. It could be hemolytic, it could be aplastic, it could be sequestration. They should also be taught in the younger child to feel the spleen very, very gently. You know, sometimes the child just turns white and the spleen size increases. They need to come. Also, when they do come with a child, the hospitals where they are patients, following up regularly, need to have a card which can kind of gives them fast track to come in, because it's an emergency in these kids if they have a fever or any of the other complications.
Right. Okay. Thank you, Archana.
Patient came to OPD 10 days after discharge with complaints of swelling, redness, increased temperature over right leg and both hands, forearm associated with high grade fever since 2 to 3 days. There was non-compliance to medicines. X-ray was done, which was suggestive of osteolytic changes with multiple fractures involving right ulna and radius, left ulna, right femur, tibia and fibula, left distal femur. So antibiotics were started, orthoreference was done, complete immobilization was done.
Yeah.
Hello.
Yeah. So, Dr. Deepthi, this child had presented with multiple fractures. So, how common are multiple fractures seen in children with sickle cell disease? And what are the different bone manifestations which we see in sickle cell disease?
Okay. Usually, the bone manifestations, they change from according to the age. Till the age of 3-4 years, we see dactylitis, what we call as hand foot syndrome. Probably this child had that, swelling over the dorsum of hand and foot. So the common presentation is hand foot syndrome till 3 to 4 years. Then it changes to larger joints, elbow and knee joint and ankle joint. And then in adulthood, they also involve back, spine and flat bones, ribs. So this is the site, how it varies with age usually in patients with sickle cell disease. The bony involvement which we commonly see is the bone infarct due to repeated VOC. The other thing very commonly seen and very difficult to treat is osteomyelitis, because it takes a long time, not only 6 weeks, it takes longer time, and it occurs again and again. And the usual organism, as already discussed, are Salmonella, but Staph is a very common organism we see in patients with osteomyelitis. As the age advances, usually in the second decade, we get avascular necrosis of bone, usually the hip joint and many a times the shoulder. Hip is very symptomatic, comes with pain, difficulty in walking. However, shoulder, in spite of a lot of necrosis, the symptoms are very less. So this is the bony involvement we see, and rarely in patients with sickle cell disease yet, though I have read reports in literature about it.
Right, ma'am.
So MRI of lower limbs was done, which was suggestive of multifocal areas of osteomyelitis with stern hyperintensity with contrast enhancement in right iliac bone, distal right femoral shaft epiphysis, right calcaneum, first and fourth metatarsal, distal left femoral epiphysis, left first metatarsal, calcaneum and cuboid. Patient was shifted to IPCU for exchange transfusion as there was extensive bone necrosis due to sickling crisis. This was the investigation. At present, HB was 9 with a total count of 13,000 with neutrophilic predominance 74%. Platelets were 7.74. CR was 35. On admission, HBS was 76.8. We did an exchange transfusion for the child, and post exchange transfusion, his HB was 10 with total counts of 9,300. Platelets were 4 lakh. And HBS was 13.4%. So after that, patient was taken for debridement and decompression of right femur, tibia, right ulna radius, and left ulna. Immobilization was done and sample was sent for HP histopathological examination. Pus culture and BACTEC showed no growth. Histopath was suggestive of non-tubercular osteomyelitis. Physiotherapy and gradual mobilization was done. He completed 6 weeks of antibiotics. Repeat x-rays was done, which showed complete healing. Child was discharged on capsule hydroxyurea, folate, and penicillin prophylaxis. On follow-up, patient had high transcranial Doppler readings for which he was put on chronic transfusion therapy.
I think we've already talked about the role of transcranial Doppler in patients with sickle cell disease. Now, this child was 1 year, 7 months. We usually start.
Can you tell, like, how a child with sickle cell, if he comes with a stroke, how that child should be managed?
Yes. I would say that the first thing we do. I just want to add one thing on transcranial Doppler, which has been very well covered previously by you, Madam, Sangeeta Madam. It was that we have two types of machines to do transcranial Doppler. One is the imaging and the non-imaging. The non-imaging is portable and we can carry it to the community and in the field also. So we can do TCDs in field also. That is what I wanted to add here. Now, management of stroke in children, usually it is ischemic stroke, and as they grow it becomes hemorrhagic. So the first thing which we will do is a CT scan to rule out hemorrhage, put the child on oxygen IV fluid, and in our setup the incidence of stroke is around 8 to 10% in our clinic. And after giving IV fluids and this, we will look at the hemoglobin, and it is not the hemoglobin level which we are going to treat now. What we want is what was his steady level hemoglobin level. Now it is even for indication of transfusion, we do not look at the hemoglobin level, bring it to 9 or 8. What, because my patients, most of them, the hemoglobin level is between 5 to 6 grams. So what is their steady level hemoglobin? If it is less, then we will give a simple transfusion, or we go ahead with an exchange transfusion. And this has to be repeated at least 3 times in a patient of stroke. And earlier you do the exchange, less are the chances of recurrence. And then we put the child on hydroxyurea if he's not on hydroxyurea. And here the dose is higher than what we give to the other children. We start with 15 to 20 milligram of hydroxyurea. And call the child for exchange transfusion every month, which they usually don't come. We are happy even if they come once in 3 months, but they are called every 3 months to bring down the hemoglobin S level below 30%. But still, with all this, recurrent strokes are common in 5 to 10% of the patients.
So we've seen that this child came with a lot of complications. He had multiple fractures to begin with, and then he had abnormal transcranial Doppler as well. Dr. Prashant,
Do you think this child is a candidate for bone marrow transplant? And what are the other indications for bone marrow transplant in a child with sickle cell disease? Dr. Prashant, are you there?
I think Dr. Prashant, I can't see.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yeah, yes. Now we can hear you, Prashant.
Yeah, sorry.
This child had presented with multiple fractures.
Yeah, I have heard it. I know the story. So, this child would definitely be a candidate for bone marrow transplantation with so much bony involvement and abnormal transcranial Dopplers. The long-term survival of this child would be definitely compromised. So without a doubt, this child would be a candidate for bone marrow transplantation. Bone marrow transplantation in sickle cell disease is relatively easy compared to transplantation in thalassemia. For example, in this child, I would also consider a haploidentical transplantation because of so much morbidity that this child has come in with. Other indications of bone marrow transplantation in sickle cell disease are recurrent chest crisis, recurrent visceral organ involvement like hepatopathy is also an indication. Pulmonary involvement in the sense that if the child has had recurrent chest crisis in the past and has an evidence of pulmonary decompensation, then those children would also benefit from bone marrow. And a child who's got a terrible quality of life due to recurrent vaso-occlusive crisis, so if they have got recurrent vaso-occlusive crisis more than 4 to 6 times a year, would also be considered for transplant in the context of sickle cell disease. Now, fortunately, I think Indian sickle cell transplant is not that bad, and the severity is not as bad as African children. So we don't tend to see severe end of sickle cell disease here, but clearly some of these children that you have presented would benefit from bone marrow transplantation.
And what are the conditioning regimens you would use in this patient?
So I think in sickle cell disease, it's very simple. I mean, you go for reduced toxicity, but myeloablative conditioning regimen. That would be a simple answer. Of course, it's not always that straightforward. Every child is different. So we have to think what conditioning regimen a particular child would benefit from. But in general, fludarabine, triosulfan, thiotipa, with some serotherapy would be a standard conditioning regimen for any child with sickle cell disease. So that's what we would do to condition them.
Okay, thank you so much, Prashant.
Just out of interest, I mean, this child with multiple fractures, and we didn't grow any organism. So it is most likely to be all sickle related rather than an infection related in this child.
Yes. So in this case, we tried to cover most of the complications which may face in sickle cell disease. This is another case which Sana will present now. This child came to us at the peak of the lockdown and we had a lot of difficulty managing her. And so we'll just talk about her and take the expert opinion.
Coming to the second case, 6.5-year-old female child, first by birth order, born of third degree consanguineous marriage, Mahar community, known case of sickle cell anemia, diagnosed at 3.5 years of age. She presented with complaints of yellowish discoloration of eyes, abdominal distension since 15 days, swelling over both eyes and feet since 10 days, fever since 5 to 6 days, and high colored urine since 1 day. Patient was apparently all right 15 days back when she developed yellowish discoloration of eyes and skin and abdominal distension associated with pain and nausea, for which patient took some Ayurvedic medicines. There was also history of swelling over bilateral feet, which was gradual in onset, progressively increased to involve abdomen and around eyes, not associated with any diurnal or postural variation. there was a history of fever, mild to moderate grade, not associated with chills, relieved temporarily on medications. There was history of passing high colored urine and no history of vomiting, bleeding manifestations, altered sleep pattern, convulsions, altered sensorium, pale stools, decreased urine output, or decreased appetite.
So, Dr. Chandrakala, what are what are the different manifestations of liver involvement in a child with sickle cell disease?
In a patient with sickle cell disease, like any other hemolytic anemia, they will have cholelithiasis and cholecystitis, which is the most common we see. And it can be acute cholecystitis or the chronic cholecystitis. And then we have other manifestations, which is secondary to the sickling. Sickling can cause acute sickle hepatic crisis, acute sickle intrahepatic cholecystitis, and acute hepatic sequestrations. So these are the three more important things we have to differentiate when the patient comes with like a sickle cell anemia, comes with a jaundice. Coming to the sickle hepatic crisis, it is like a more of a benign type. Actually, acute hepatic crisis is, it's like first one is like, it's a benign type where you have bilirubin will not be more than 15, maybe up to like 15 is the highest we see. And here the enzymes are not very high. It's like hundreds, like 300, maybe like 400, 500. Enzymes will not be very high. Patients, the coagulation parameters will be normal. Patients' renal parameters will be normal. So in this patient, this is called something like it's a benign hepatic cholecystitis, that is benign disorder. So you can observe these patients, but the patient is worsening, then they require extreme transfusion. The more fatal is acute sickle intrahepatic cholecystitis. So this is like an emergency. Patient comes, you have to treat the patient immediately. Other patient, you can lose the patient. Here the patient has bilirubin can be like in up to like 50, 60 can be there. And enzymes will be usually in thousands. Like enzymes, like it's like a necrosis, enzyme will be in thousands. And the coagulation parameters are deranged, PTA-PTA deranged, fibrinogen is deranged, and the patient's renal parameters are deranged. Here you have to do the exchange transfusion is a must, because otherwise the patients will die because of the complication. And otherwise, acute hepatic sequestration, that is because the patient, the sequestration of the cells happens, and you can identify because of anemia and liver is like palpable. The remaining things, because of the recurrent transfusion, viral infections and iron overload can be seen. And rarely sickle can come with Budgeri syndrome. So always keep it in mind, Budgeri syndrome can also come with a patient with acute abdomen in sickle.
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Chandrakala.
Past history. Patient was diagnosed at 3 years of age as a case of sickle cell anemia when she presented with fever, bilateral knee joint and right wrist swelling and pain. She was started with hydroxyurea, penicillin prophylaxis and folvite. Family history, she was born out of third degree consanguineous marriage. Both parents were sickle trait. And she had a 3.5-year-old male sibling who was also a case of sickle cell anemia.
So this child, other sibling also has got sickle cell anemia. What are the important aspects of counseling in a child for the parents? Archana, can you please throw most of the things you covered in the previous case, but like any other things which are important to tell the parents? Dr. Archana.
Okay. So in these parents where the child has been diagnosed to have sickle cell anemia,
there's another child who is also got sickle cell
anemia. Yes, I noted that. So you need to give them a lot of information, and sometimes you have to break the information in parts, and this has to be reinforced at regular intervals. As you can see for this child, they have another child who's younger and has sickle cell anemia. So even if they were counseled earlier, I don't know how much of it stayed with them. Also, they stayed at home for a longish time with this child till she worsened even more and tried some Ayurvedic medicines, etc. So when a child is diagnosed with sickle cell anemia, you definitely need to explain to them the nature of the condition, the complications that can occur and how they need to come immediately. The child was on the right medications. She was on hydroxyurea, she was on penicillin, and she was on folic acid. So this has to be started. When they are started on hydroxyurea, you have to tell them that they have to come every month for a blood test to make sure that there are no side effects of the hydroxyurea that has been started. Also, they have to take their penicillin prophylaxis properly, and the reason why they have to do that. And also, I mentioned about monitoring all the complications that they have to. Sangeeta has already touched upon the prenatal diagnosis and the neonatal screening, which has to be told to them that if this had been emphasized, maybe the next child wouldn't have had sickle cell anemia. Also, the extended family needs to be checked as well. Now, they also need to make sure that the child has good nutrition, the child is well hydrated at all times, that is both the kids. Also that the child needs to be kept warm, because we know in the cold weather, they can have sickling crisis. Also to try and avoid high altitudes as far as possible. Also after all this has been explained to them and they've come to terms with it, we need to tell them that they are sickle cell traits, both of them. And usually sickle cell traits don't have problems, but if they have severe dehydration or if they do very strenuous physical activity, then even they can have sickling. So this also has to be explained to them. And as I mentioned earlier, the rest of the family has to be tested for sickling as well, so that the prognosis of their future progeny, etc., can be explained to them.
Yeah, thank you.
And simple measures like avoiding diarrhea or gastroenteritis, you know, hand washing and cleaning the water hygiene, food hygiene, making sure also we need to protect them from malaria. Most of them come from malaria endemic areas. Now, not that malaria has a higher propensity for sickle cell kids, but the hemolysis can cause a lot of problems. So having mosquito nets, things like that, those kind of measures.
All right. Thank you, Archana.
Birth history. He was full term. Born by LSCS, cried immediately after birth, 2.5 kg, and no history of NICU stay. Developmental history was normal for age, and immunization completed till date, and received special vaccines. Diet history was mixed diet, adequate calories and proteins for age. Coming to the anthropometry, weight was 19.4 kg, which was, according to the IAP growth chart, at the 25th centile. Height was 112 centimeters, which was between 10 to 25th centile. And BMI was 15.6, which was above 50th centile. On general examination, she was 8 febrile with a heart rate of 92 per minute, RR of 26 per minute, blood pressure of 94/62 mm of mercury. Peripheral pulses were well felt. CRT was less than 3 seconds. Pallor was there. Icterus was present. Fetal edema was present, periorbital puffiness was there. There was no signs of liver cell dysfunction. Systemic examination. Per abdomen, on inspection, it was distended. Umbilicus was transversely stretched. No dilated veins or scar marks were there. On palpation, liver was 7 centimeters below right costal margin. It was firm, smooth surface, rounded margins, tender, and left lobe was palpable with a span of 10 centimeters. Spleen was palpated. It was 2 centimeters below left costal margin. It was firm and non-tender. Abdominal girth was 58.5 centimeters and free fluid was present. Rest of the systemic examination was normal. Coming to the investigations, HB was 4.7 with HCP of 15.6. Retic was 15% with a corrected retic of 4.7%. Total counts were 19,000 with a neutrophilic predominance of 60%. Platelets were 1,64,000. Total bilirubin was 15.6 with a direct component of 12.1. SGOPT was 10 and SGOT was 119. Alkaline phosphatase was 22. RFT were normal. PT was deranged with a 48. INR was 4.2 and APTT was 61 with low albumin of 1.7. So at that point of time, FFP, PRBC was given. Vitamin A, D, E, K were started. Udalip, hepatic drip, and injection taxim was given.
So Dr. Deepthi, what do you think this child has got? Dr. Chandrakala mentioned many of the causes of hepatic dysfunction in children with sickle cell. What could be the possible cause in this child?
Can I ask a question? Has he ever received blood transfusion?
No.
And what about steady state hemoglobin level? Because these two factors will tell me what, can give me a clue, right? What was the steady state hemoglobin level if we have one?
Ma'am, she never received the blood transfusions in past and her hemoglobins were between 8 to 8.5.
Okay. So I would put this child as a right upper quadrant syndrome, what we call in sickle cell disease patient, where we have to differentiate between an obstructive cholestasis and a acute hepatopathy, sickle hepatopathy. And here we find that hemoglobin is low because if it was 8 and now it has 5, so definitely there is a fall in hemoglobin. Bilirubin is less than 15, 12, so moderate hyperbilirubinemia. The enzymes are also not much raised, nor is alkaline phosphatase. However, there is hepatic dysfunction. So I would put this child as a hepatic crisis with hepatic dysfunction. And the etiology will depend on the investigations. And as of now, it does not fit into the sequestration crisis because sequestration crisis will not have a coagulation problem, nor is it intrahepatic cholestasis. As of now, as we go further, we may find rise in hemoglobin and rise in bilirubin level, and we may have a different diagnosis. So right now, I would focus mainly on my treatment and give supportive care and of course ADEK and also FFP and transfusion. So this would be my management, and it is difficult to pinpoint exactly the what was the etiology, and I will put it as right upper quadrant syndrome.
I agree with you, Dr. Deepthi. Yeah, so these are the further investigations.
GGTP was 122, which later became 86. Ammonia at presentation was 72, which later became 118. Triple H was negative. Hepatitis E, A and hepatitis E, IgM antibodies were negative. DCT was negative. Dengue, PSMP, typhi dot was done, which was negative. UHC was suggestive of congestive hepatomegaly with splenomegaly and ascites with bilateral pleural effusion with basal collapse. Urine routine microscopy showed bile salts and bile pigments which were present. Patient was shifted to IPCU on day of admission of 3 in view of rising bilirubin, deranged coagulation profile with increased sleepiness. In IPCU, antibiotics were upgraded and exchange transfusion was planned. Exchange transfusion was done with pre-transfusion HBLC showing HBS of 48.4 and post-exchange transfusion HBS was 16.8. Later that day, patient got intubated in view of deteriorating sensorium and impending respiratory failure. Her HP was 6 on day of admission. On 4th, with a retic of 15.1% and total counts of 22,000. And following which, exchange transfusion, HB was 9.4 with the counts of 30,000 and platelets of 50,000. And bilirubin had increased from 28 to 33 and with serially kept on increasing to 39 with a direct component of 24.7 and then it became 47.7 and with a direct component of 31.5. And with showing deranged coagulation profile. Later on, patient developed ARDS with pulmonary bleed, received FFP, cryoprecipitate, NRDP. Next day, patient had respiratory acidosis, pulmonary bleed, worsening DIC with rising bilirubin, which became 47. Repeat exchange transfusion was planned, but patient succumbed due to ARDS and pulmonary hemorrhage.
So in this child, what we was we transfused her, but still the bilirubin, still the hemoglobin was not going up. Dr. Prashant, can you tell like what are the causes if you transfuse and the hemoglobin is not going up? What can be the causes and what is a hyperhemolytic syndrome in a sickle cell disease?
Yeah. So the cause if you are transfusing and the hemoglobin is not going up is. Hello?
Yeah, yeah.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
So the causes of no increment in hemoglobin in a child with sickle cell, I mean, the most important cause is hyperhemolytic syndrome, wherein there is hemolysis of the transfused red cells. No matter what, how much red cells you transfuse. Etiology of hyperhemolytic syndrome, why it happens is we don't understand it yet, but there is a suggestion that it's a disorder similar to some form of macrophage activation erythrophagocytosis, and the treatment is with steroids and IVIG. So that's the treatment for hyperhemolytic syndrome. The diagnosis for hyperhemolytic syndrome is again not easy to make. Ferritin is usually elevated more than the baseline in hyperhemolytic syndrome, and there is reticulocytopenia rather than reticulocytosis at the time of hyperhemolytic syndrome. So it's a complication of sickle cell disease that is not very well understood. In addition to that, why the Hb increment doesn't happen in sickle cell is if there is a sequestration in one of the organs, usually the spleen. If you're giving blood and you're not getting increment, then that could be another reason for not getting increment. So those are the two reasons I could think of. I'll let Dr. Chandrakala add if she's got anything more.
Dr. Chandrakala, would you like to add up anything more?
Yeah, the alloantibodies you have mentioned, no, that is an important cause actually. In sickle, no, after exchange transfusion, that's a risky. We see in adults also formation of alloantibodies. Even if keep on transfusing, the hemoglobin doesn't improve. But for this patient, because the PTFE continuously was increased, and enzyme was normal, it's surprising. It's only we can call it as upper quadrant syndrome. But the one thing we have to keep it in mind is alloantibodies also has to be kept in mind. And usually alloantibodies doesn't respond to steroids. The response is very less compared to autoantibodies. IVIG, maybe like rituximab is preferable to give in these patients with alloimmunization.
Any role of eculizumab or plasma exchange?
Eculizumab in sickle, I am not aware of it actually. And giving a plasma exchange in a patient with all the coagulation disorders, all the coagulation parameters deranged is also very, very high risk. So maybe the IVIG will be a better option, but considering the PTFE, everything is deranged, still she will not fit into one diagnosis.
Actually. Right.
Yeah, this particular patient, I don't think we can conclude anything about it other than the fact that the liver was significantly involved due to a reason that we don't understand and that led to multi-organ failure.
Yes, yeah. So how do we manage a sickle cell hepatopathy?
See, in patient with benign, sometimes patient bilirubin is, like 20, 30 enzymes bang normal, like maybe SGOT, a little bit of hemolysis will be high. See, those patients, they are okay in the hospital, nothing, PTFE is normal, creatinine is normal. So just observe them, because of the only thing is we have to monitor the complications. But when the enzymes are on the higher side, like more than 300, and PTFE deranged, then exchange transfusion has to be there, otherwise they will go into multi-organ failure. That's usually the dictum, give the HBS has to be less than 30%.
Yeah. So
that's what, and ultimately the liver transplant when the patient doesn't improve as an acute management we have to consider.
Mm-hmm. So as I mentioned, this child came in at the peak of the lockdown. She had like already spent 15 days at home
without any treatment, and then unfortunately after coming here also she kept deteriorating, and in this particular case we could not pinpoint exactly what is the diagnosis. Initially from the history looked like hepatic crisis, then from the investigations we initially thought it's sequestration, but then the bilirubin kept on increasing and she went into hepatic encephalopathy. So unfortunately this child didn't make it, but we just learned about what are the different manifestations of sickle hepatopathy or sickle involvement of liver in the sickle cell disease. India is the second highest burden of sickle cell disease in the world, and clinical presentation among sickle cell disease is quite variable. We learned when we discussed with our esteemed faculty. Management involves treatment of acute manifestations as well as prevention of end organ damage. All the patients of sickle cell anemia should be treated with hydroxyurea, and parental education is very, very important. I can't see any of the questions in the chat. Maybe I can ask Dr. Poorna to see.
Dr. Sangeeta, sorry to interfere. There are some questions, so if I will read them out, and then I think you can probably.
Okay.
So there are three questions which I can see which has not been answered yet. One was on the exchange transfusion in a sickle cell disease crisis. So the question is that will you monitor clinically, or you'll monitor your goal will be HbF of SBS of less than 30%. So what will you do? So that was an exchange transfusion. And the second question is also an exchange transfusion. I think Dr. Dipti ma'am mentioned that for long-term exchange is for example patient with stroke, for example, you'll call them for exchanges. So the second question in that is what venous access would you prefer for a long-term exchange? So these are two questions on exchange transfusion.
Dipti madam, do you want to take these questions?
Sure. Ideally, you should be, for the first question, the answer is ideally you should be looking at the hemoglobin S levels. However, this is not feasible in our setup. So we do clinical parameters, and hardly I have done hemoglobin S. We do exchange very commonly, but we are not able to monitor S level. This is what we do, but that is not ideal. But then we do get clinical improvement, and that's it. For the second question, the access is not difficult. If once only I had difficulty and we had to put a central line, which is not advocated for exchange. So we did with a femoral vein. We inserted the needle in a femoral vein. It's not a problem in our place getting an IV line. That was the question, right? When you put them on chronic transfusion, what about the access to IV lines? It has not been a very common problem.
No, I think the background to that question must have been, ma'am, because, a lot of our nephrology colleagues put, fistulas, venous fistulas.
So actually, my patients like are, oldest is around 28, and till now, not for exchange.
The other question, which is still unanswered, Dr. Sangeeta, is, it has been partially been answered though, but I think we can probably discuss it a little bit more because it's a very common question, which, comes across. That is on hydroxyurea long-term use and its effect on fertility. So how do we counsel them on fertility? What precautions, probably, I can add to that question, what precautions we can take, probably before these, couples plan conception. And also, is there any role of fertility preservation in these children when they grow up?
Okay. So I would request Dr. Chandrakala to throw more light on it. She deals with more of adult patients as well. So Dr. Chandrakala, what is the effect of fertility? What is the effect of hydroxyurea and fertility?
There are a lot of studies and long-term studies up to 30, 40 years has been done. The other thing always patients ask about the leukemia, increased incidence of leukemia, but it has been ruled out because hardly any single or two cases has been reported and not association. There is no association between hydroxyurea in sickle and leukemia has been done. So the association is not there. The other thing we always consider about the fertility issue. In fertility issue, there has been even NIH guidelines mentions that the male who are taking hydroxyurea can have a decreased sperm count and the sperm dysfunction can be there. So you always have to counsel the patient regarding this sperm dysfunction and the sperm count will be decreased. If somebody wants to preserve the sperm, they can preserve the sperm. But in our practical scenario, what happens is nobody is willing for sperm preservation. So we tell them, try for the conception. If not possible, stop for 3 months. See the sperm count, sperm motility. If it's problem, then you stop for 3 months and then you try for the conception. But always make consent has to be taken prior to starting hydroxy in adults regarding the sperm issues. For females, you have to stop hydroxy at least 3 months to 3 months prior to pregnancy. And during pregnancy also, you should stop the hydroxyurea. But becomes very difficult if somebody has got a recurrent crisis. So it's very difficult to stop throughout the pregnancy because increased chance of vaso-occlusive crisis, acute chest syndrome. What we usually do is on the end of second trimester, we start the hydroxyurea and stop at least about 1 month prior to delivery because of myelosuppression. So counseling regarding the sperm and stopping prior to pregnancy, maybe restarting during the second and third trimester is the feasible thing in the clinical practical scenario.
Right. Okay. Thank you, Dr. Chandrakala. Are there any questions?
May I ask a question?
Yeah, please.
I think Dr. Archana, you know, I think she explained beautifully the counseling part. I have a question on the genetic counseling part with regards to antenatal testing. I personally feel that it's very difficult with thalassemia as compared to sickle cell. Thalassemia, I think we are quite confident in guiding them what to do once antenatal testing has been done. So what is the practice, because as Dr. Dipti already mentioned, the phenotype is so varied even within the families. If there's a first baby of first child of this family or even the second child of this family, where we are doing an antenatal testing and looking for the homozygous state, what would be our, because most of the times they will probably, you ask you to guide them. What is the practice? What are the families or couples, being counseled for, for a termination of the pregnancy, or just explaining them the phenotype and letting them take a call. So what is the practice, being followed? Because in sickle cell, it is different and difficult.
Yeah, I think I agree with you. We have to just explain them and give them details on what are the possible complications or morbidities the child can experience. And then the decision has to be taken by the parents. So they will have to be given a choice as in what they want to do.
See, if they go for a prenatal diagnosis, then you know that they're mentally prepared to, maybe they've seen somebody else going through sickle cell anemia. And the fact that they've gone for a prenatal diagnosis means somewhere they're okay with maybe not continuing the pregnancy if the child does turn up positive. Otherwise, you would just suggest a neonatal screening, so that the child is best managed right from day one. So you have to counsel them and then they take it from there.
Actually, does that answer? Sorry, Archana, you can carry.
Yeah, sure.
Now with time, we have seen that sickle cell patients are also going for prenatal diagnosis. Once we do prenatal diagnosis, we give them options. And most of them will follow proper genetic counseling and do, if the child is homozygous, go for termination. However, rarely we see, I think I've come across 3 patients who even after doing prenatal diagnosis, SS, they did not terminate the pregnancy. We do come across, but very rare.
Right. That's exactly what I was trying to say. They go for prenatal diagnosis. They're already more inclined to maybe not continue the pregnancy if the child is a sickle cell anemia.
Right.
Thank you very much. So any more questions anyone has? I think we have overshot the time also. So I take the liberty of concluding the session. Dr. Sangeeta, it was excellent. I think, as I said earlier, probably less discussed and less talked about topic and was very relevant to be discussed today. Thank you very much for your time and all the faculty, all the experts who had taken the time out to share their experiences with us. And we, you know, the panelists were, people who had 30 years of experience, 40 years of experience in this field. So we really appreciate your contribution, ma'am. So I also should thank our program, committee, Neeta, Anand, and Ria, who coordinates these sessions every week, and also Echo, who provides a platform for holding these sessions. So thank you very much, everyone, for your contribution. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Diti, Archana, Prashant, and
thank you.
Dr. Chandrakala.
Thank you.
Bye, everyone.
Thank you. Thank you.